The way we see maintenance being done, major maintenance work, you have preventive maintenance. Preventive maintenance, all maintenance done to prevent a failure or detect a failure early. That's what we call it. So we have the prevent part and the inspection part. Continuous improvements, you may have some of those. Those are the really things that to be done from redesigns. So if you redesign a piece of equipment, I can see you doing that in two cases. One is if you have a root cause and you see whatever you have a problem on. If you have a piece of equipment that's not working right, it could also be a process. You may have to redesign it. And that's really that you design out maintenance. You're trying to redesign something to work better. So we may say, we have motors, so we need to go around and lubricate motors. You know what? We're going to start purchasing motors. We need to redesign a motor, but we may start purchasing motors that have sealed bearings. So now we don't need to do lubrication on them. That would be kind of designing out maintenance. Design for reliability. We won't talk much about this. This is very interesting. It's almost a whole course in itself. But when we buy equipment, do we design so that we can maintain it easy, so we can actually run better, or do we buy the cheapest that we can possibly get? Do we actually look at reliability when we buy something? Do we buy the same couplings? We don't have 80 different types of couplings. So because you have 5 types of couplings and then you have 10 sizes of each one, there's 50 couplings in your storeroom. Why don't we just say, look, we're going to have 2 couplings. We're going to have gear couplings and we're going to have Atraflex couplings. That's it. Or if it's an Omega coupling and this, you know, we'd stay with 2 sorts. We'd reduce our storeroom inventory. Those are the things we talk about, really designing for reliability, thinking about what do we buy? Do we buy the cheapest? Do we buy the best? Do we buy the ones that are cheapest to own and operate and buy, or just the one that's cheaper to buy? We can do corrective maintenance. So corrective maintenance, we can do 3 to 4 different ways. We can do what we call break-in work. Break-in work is something that's done that we start doing today, tomorrow. If we can look in a daily schedule, we can say anything that's done after that's added to the schedule, assuming we have a schedule, but if anything's added for tomorrow's work after 12 o'clock today is a break-in job. Now that could be a breakdown, but it can also be somebody who's coming from the side and say, we need to do this work today. It's a break-in job. Sometimes breaking jobs are valid. Sometimes you have to do them. You don't have a choice. Sometimes they're not valid. You follow me with that? So that's the priority one, breaking job. Doesn't matter if it's a breakdown or not. The reason for that is different. We have to analyze that, and that's important. The other thing we can do is only scheduled. Most people I work with, we do schedule work. So we're trying to, the week before, and saying, okay, you're going to do this job, you're going to do that, you're going to do this. We're trying to get kind of some type of daily or weekly schedule together and say, these are the work orders we're going to do the next few days. For the most part, people have some type of scheduling. We have some work that's only planned, meaning we plan the work, we get the tools, materials, we get all the work instructions and everything's ready to go, but we don't know when to do it because we can't inspect it. So we know we're going to have something that's going to run to a breakdown, but we don't know when that breakdown is going to happen. I can't inspect it. Some electronics are like that. What you may want to do is kit and stage and say, okay, when this happens, at least I have the parts and tools and everything ready to go so I can do this job quicker. Sometimes we don't have an option. We'll go through that in a second. And of course, if we can, we want to have it both planned and scheduled. That's really what we want to do. So if we take a typical, very simple job, let's say we have a leaking packing. So if we actually do an inspection and find, we go an inspection route and we find that leaking packing, if we want to really draw it to the nth degree here, finding the packing leak would be actually an inspection, condition monitoring, preventive maintenance. Tightening it up and fixing it, if that's what fixes it, that would actually be a corrective action. Now, you wouldn't divide that up into 2 work orders, obviously. But if you want to look at the progression, vibration analysis, if we find a bearing that's actually having a high vibration, that would be my preventive maintenance. Now, changing that bearing out, that would be a corrective maintenance. What a lot of people are saying, we should have as high preventive maintenance as possible. We should measure how much percent of our work is preventive maintenance. And the higher, the better. With using our definition, that's not quite true. Because a lot of people include the change of the bearing as a preventive maintenance. That's not a preventive maintenance. What it is a planned and scheduled work order. It's corrective because we're changing it out. But it's a planned and scheduled we're striving for in the corrective action. Some people use different definitions. I just want to say what we use so you see where we're coming from when we talk about preventive maintenance.